Good morning. Welcome to Grove Church. My name is Pastor Steve. This is our online worship gathering. Get a bread and a cup of juice as we're going to, after the sermon, celebrate the sacraments of the Lord's Supper. But we're so glad that you have created this space to connect with God, to start the new year off with God's people. Happy New Year. Welcome to Grove Church. So in our time together, we're going to have some liturgy to prepare our hearts and encounter God. We're going to have songs of worship to praise God. We're going to have a message for the children and a sermon. We're going to go back to the Gospel of John to learn what it means to follow Jesus. So we're going to do that all together. So our beginning is a call to worship, an invitation to worship God from Psalm 118:24. It's a reminder. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. As we are glad for and rejoice at what God is doing, rejoice in what God has started and will bring to completion, we also realize that we have things that are holding us back, that are places where we need God to forgive us and restore us. So let us not start a new year with our old sin and ask for Him to restore us, renew us. Our prayer of confession is guided by our world belongs to God. So following the apostles, the church, which is you and I, are sent with the gospel of the kingdom to make disciples of all nations, to feed the hungry, and to proclaim the assurance that in the name of Christ, there's forgiveness of sin and new life for all who repent and believe, to tell the news that our world belongs to God. In a world estranged from God, where millions face confusing choices, this mission is central to our being. For we announce that one name that saves. We repent of leaving this work to a few. Forgive us, Lord. Help us to live as your disciples of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. We pray for brothers and sisters who suffer for the faith, and we rejoice that the Spirit is waking us to see our mission in God's world. Amen. So as we are woken to what God is doing, and God forgives us and restores us, hear this assurance of God's new work that He wants to do in us from Romans 8. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Thanks be to God. As God has given us peace, forgiveness, restoration, assurance of Him doing a good work in us, let us pass that peace and greet each other with signs of Christ's peace. The peace of Christ be with you all at home and also with you. So in the comments section, let us embrace each other, welcome this new year together, rejoice in the peace that Christ brings. Welcome. Peace be with you. Happy New Year. Welcome. All right. Now let us continue to worship God. This time we'll have a message for the children. Now will the children gather around. Hey kids, it's Pastor Steve, and I hope you have a great start to this new year. I hope it's been fun, exciting. You're having maybe a little bit break from school before you go back. I know some of you are going back virtual, some of you are going back in the building. But whatever it is, I hope it's great. I hope you're having a lot of fun at home and experiencing the love of family and the love of God. We're still in the book of John. John is one of the four gospels that talk about Jesus. And today I'm going to talk about how people started following Jesus, right? Are you a follower of Jesus? Right? We all should be followers when we're friends with Jesus. He
He's not just any friend. We also follow him and follow his ways and follow what he tells us. And we do that in the Bible. It tells us how to follow Jesus and how to love like Jesus and live like Jesus. So Jesus, in some ways, is a sign. He's a sign of that says, follow, come and follow, come and see, follow me, and I will show you what God is like. He points us, Jesus points us to God. So we follow God, we follow Jesus, and he follows, helps us to follow God, to follow his ways. But sometimes we, you know, so every time we look at Jesus, he tells us, you know, look up, look to God. This is what God is like. And he's like an ongoing sign of pointing us to God, telling us what God is like, telling us how to live like and love like we should, because that's the way that God wants us to. But do you listen all the time? I mean, all the time? Sometimes we don't listen to God. Even though Jesus points us to God and tells us what he's like, sometimes we want to go our own way. Have you ever, instead of saying, okay, instead of, I'm not going to do things Jesus' way, I'm going to, you know, maybe tell a lie or hurt someone or not listen or hurt other people's feelings or maybe even steal or cheat, right? We do things our own way and we end up going not God's way, not pointing to God, but live lives that are farther away from God than our own way. But then Jesus continues to tell us and to point us back to God. He continues to say, okay, you made your mistake, you're going your way, but look up to God, follow Jesus. All right, he continues to do that and continues to help us to follow him, that we know the way that we should live. And on again, we may go our own way, but Jesus always points us to who? To God, right? And then we get tempted and you make another, and you're going to make mistakes. And you're going to make bad decisions and you're going to want to go your own way. You're going to want to follow, be your own leader. But then what does Jesus tell us? Come to me. Follow God. Live my way. Love like me. And that's, we remind each other to keep on following God. To keep on following Jesus. To continue to go the way that Jesus showed us to go. And like I said, we always want to go our own way. But he is the only way. He's the way, the truth, and the life. So friends, follow Jesus. Look at Jesus. Be forever friends with Jesus, and he will show us the right way to go. Even when we make mistakes and want to go our own way. Can you pray with me? God, we make mistakes. We hurt people. We tell lies. We're not loving and kind. Sometimes we do wrong, but we thank you, God, that you always help us and welcome us to do right, to love like you, to turn around our ways, to see you. Help us be true followers, Jesus. Help us not to get lost in our own ideas, but to find you, because your ways are best. Your ways are loving and true and beautiful. Lord, we pray for these kids in this new calendar year. We pray that you be with them, even if things are different at school or in different situations or circumstances. We pray that they may experience your peace, that you may give their parents wisdom to navigate these unforeseen times. We thank you, Lord, that you point us to yourself and direct our paths. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, guys. God bless. And stick around, and we're going to worship God together in song. I want to hear you singing.
Of his mercy, as deep cries out to deep. We sing, come Lord Jesus, come. Come Lord Jesus, come. We sing, come. Dip your heart in the stream of life, let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of His mercy as deep cries out to deep. We sing, come Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. We sing, come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come.
Friends, once again, let us turn our thoughts upward and our eyes to the scriptures as we revisit John chapter 1, this time starting at verse 35. Friends, hear these words from the book that we love. The next day, John was there again with two of his disciples. When he saw Jesus passing by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." When the two disciples heard him say this, they turned and followed him. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, "What do you want?" They said, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" "Come," he replied, "and you will see." So they went and saw where he was staying, and they spent that day with him. It was about 4 in the afternoon. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two that heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus.
The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, "We have found the Messiah," that is the Christ. And he brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas," which when translated is Peter. The next day, Jesus decided to leave for Galilee. Finding Philip, he said to him, "Follow me." Philip, like Andrew and Peter, was from the town of Bethsaida. Philip found Nathanael and told him, "We have found the one Moses wrote about in the law, and about whom the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, son of Joseph." "Nazareth? Can anything good come from there?" Nathanael asked. "Come and see," said Philip. When Jesus saw Nathanael approaching him, he said to him, "Here truly is an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." "How do you know me?" Nathanael asked. Jesus answered, "I saw you while you were still under the fig tree, before Philip called you." Then Nathanael declared, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus said, "You believe because I told you I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than that." He added then, "Very truly I tell you, you will see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man." Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Let us pray, give thanks, and ask God to guide us in our thoughts. Lord God, we look to you, Lord, as you have bridged heaven and earth, ascending and descending angels. Your Son descended and ascended. We pray, Lord, that you may lift us up, that we may encounter you, that our lives may be changed more like the way you want them to be. In your name we pray. Amen. So if you're new with us in our Bible reading time, if you have the holiday schedules have you off track, this is our third time in the first chapter of John, the fourth gospel, telling about the life and ministry of Jesus. And we're still in chapter one, so we're still just getting started. Jesus is accumulating a following. But as far as numbers go right now, John the Baptizer, who's been prominent in this first chapter, has a larger crowd of followers, a larger crowd of disciples. But John the Baptist was continually pointing to Jesus, to that Jesus is the Messiah, that Jesus is the Lamb of God. So as we read this section of John chapter 1, two of the disciples who've been following John the Baptist catch an eye on Jesus, and they follow him. They start to follow and leave the discipleship of John the Baptizer and start to follow Jesus. In this time period, it would be expected that a teacher, also our scripture tells us that rabbi and teacher are the same word, but that a teacher would have students following him around and learning from him. Learning did not happen in a classroom. It happened, as the expression goes, in the dust of the rabbi, following the rabbi, the teacher, around and listening to him speak and interact and live. This is the model of education in Jesus' day. So while Jesus was truly unique as the Son of God, as the Messiah of Scripture, his teaching style of a rabbi and the students, the disciples, following him along in life was not something that was totally unique or surprising in that day. It was a way that great teachers, great rabbis, would go and travel and have students following them around. It was a common model of education. So that's why we see that John the Baptist had followers and disciples too. So as we read here, we have this transition of two disciples of John the Baptizer start to follow Jesus and later ask him kind of a weird question of, "Where are you staying?" and spend the day with him. And after spending the day with Jesus, they are convinced that he is the Messiah. So one of those men, Andrew, tells his brother Simon Peter that they have found the one that the Bible has been talking about. And that's where we get Simon Peter come and Jesus recognizes him, even though they haven't met before, and says, "You are Peter," and renames him Peter. So that's kind of how John tells about the first gathering of disciples of Jesus. Jesus lived his life in obscurity for 30-something years. It's interesting. He lived a somewhat typical life, and at this stage, he comes and is declared and recognized as the Messiah and starts to build people who come and experience him and follow him. So the scripture continues that we read that the next day Jesus finds Philip and calls him to be a disciple by saying those famous biblical words of Jesus, "Follow me." And then Philip gets excited and experiences Jesus and tells Nathanael that Jesus is the Messiah. But Nathanael has a little bit of some doubts here of hearing that Jesus is coming from this town of Nazareth. It's insignificant. It doesn't have any Bible qualities in it. So when he comes, Jesus tells him and says, "I saw you under a fig tree." And for Philip, those were the words that he needed to hear. And all of a sudden, his questions become materialized in faith in a way that seems like almost startles Jesus of how the turnaround happened, that he says, "Yes, you are the Messiah. You are the King." And then Philip comes along and starts following Jesus. It's interesting, this these vignettes of encounters of men with different places in their lives, different questions, different prior commitments as they come and they encounter Jesus. Some of them seem to be looking more seriously about who is the Messiah, who is the Savior, right? Like those people who are following John the Baptist, you would think that they're kind of more in tune and more seeking and asking questions. And then there's some other folks that kind of seem like they were just kind of living life, and a friend told them to come check out this Jesus. But in some ways, Jesus was looking for them. When they came, when they responded, when their curiosity was piqued, Jesus called them to follow him. I find that's the way it is a lot in faith. We are seeking. We have been seeking, maybe asking questions. Some of us more intently than others. Some of us are just living life. But in reality, it is God who calls us. God who challenges us. For example, right now, if you're watching this, there's so many other things to do. There's so many, if you're on Facebook or YouTube, there's millions of videos and likes and comments. Actually, maybe right now it's even trying to distract you. You know, you're tempted to kind of multitask there because there's so many other things to do. So it's no coincidence that you are with us. You are seeking God, but in the same way, God is seeking you. God is reaching out to you. God is embracing you. You're not running and chasing a God who's hiding. God is here as you feel this curiosity, as you feel this desire, as you feel this commitment to engage in God, engage in God's word, to be part of Grove Church this morning. God is already embracing you, reaching out to you, looking for you, stirring you. And that's what we see some of those echoes in our scripture. That Jesus was, people are coming and curious and coming to him, but Jesus was actually seeking and calling people to respond in faith. But there's a lot that these new disciples don't know. They don't know where the discipleship journey is going to take them. They surely don't know where it's going to end. They have no idea that 3 years later there's going to be a crucifixion and a death and a resurrection. They haven't even witnessed any miracles. Stick around next week as we talk about that first miracle, right? So they haven't seen miracles. They don't know where they're going. They don't know what's going to happen. And even when they call Jesus the Son of God, most scholars think that they're referring to God. They still see Jesus as fully human and only human. Son of God was sometimes a title used for those who have a close connection with God. You'll see it was used for kings in the Old Testament. So they may be saying that with more truth than they even know about that this is a man of special connection with God. So they're still figuring things out. They're still, they're curious, they have lack of knowledge, they have interest. And Jesus invites them, and their friends invited them, to come and see, come and follow. This is an invitation of discipleship, to become a student of Jesus, to follow Jesus around and learn the Jesus way. I wonder this morning, do you consider yourself a disciple of Jesus? We have some folks that are watching, and you're wherever you are in your spiritual journey, you're welcome. We're glad that you're here. Some of you are skeptics, not really sure, kind of figuring stuff out, maybe have some doubts. Maybe there's some childhood issues that have really made you wonder, and you're even wondering, like, why am I spending time watching this? Some of you are believers. You have a strong faith that was raised throughout years and years, and you're just kind of solid. And there's nothing, you feel like you're good where you're at, and you know God and God's word. And some of you are somewhere in between. Some days you're firm and solid and confirmed. Other days you have doubts and questions. And we see that the disciples are people who don't have all their questions answered. Right? A disciple is not someone who's an expert, right? If you're a disciple of Jesus, you're literally a student of Jesus, right? An active student, a learner, a follower. When we see this role of disciple, it's someone who's actively pursuing Christ, who's following literally in the scriptures in the footsteps of Jesus and following the teachings of Jesus. I hope this morning that you are a disciple, or if you're not a disciple, that you would start to follow Jesus today. Not that you have all the answers, not that you know exactly what this journey will look like in its entirety, but that you're committed to come and see God's goodness in Christ. Come and see, follow Christ and learn from him. Belief is a big first step. In our scriptures, we see that they had some belief that he was who the Bible was saying he was. When we call people to believe in who Jesus is, believe is part of faith. It's trusting that the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are who they say they are. The belief should lead to action. Right? If you believe something, you act on it. It's a crazy time with Omicron is increasing around here. I don't know about where you are. But we have announcements of schools going virtual, masking mandates in Hoboken and Union City. And I know, you know, for some, it's not everyone sees eye to eye on the best ways to go. But what happens is what you believe, you live out, right? If you believe that there are certain situations that are unhealthy, unsafe, then you act accordingly. If you believe there's not much threats, if you believe that these are not big deals, then you act accordingly. Your beliefs shape your action, right? In public health, and should be in our faith in Jesus Christ. So our belief should lead to action. So we respond to the invitation of God, the call that God has extended to you through Christ. When Andrew believed that Jesus was Messiah, what did he do? He ran and told his brother. He told his brother and brought his brother to Jesus. Because if Jesus is this Messiah that we've been waiting for, I don't need to stand around and follow him for years and years before I tell my brother, hey, check him out. This is interesting. Philip responded and said, follow me, and told Nathanael. Nathanael had doubts and brought questions to Jesus. They didn't have all the answers, but they took the next steps to follow Christ, which meant telling others. Their next step was telling others and saying, hey, check out Jesus. Check out the Messiah. Check out what the person I encounter that lives up to what Scripture said. They followed and were open to seeing what Jesus was like. How are you responding to the invitation and the call of Jesus on your life? How are you responding to what God has already taught you, to what you already know about God's Word? To the stuff you heard here in our previous online church gatherings together, right? It's not just entertainment or a show. It's stuff to move on, to continue, to chew on, to live out, to follow Jesus, to come and see, and to follow. Like I said, some of you are curious or open. You're at a stage of exploration. You don't need all the answers. Maybe you have questions, but you could come and direct these questions to God himself. Nathanael had some hesitations. He wasn't sure how this squared up, and he went to encounter Christ. And in that Christ encounter, he found that who God was. So if you have questions, you have doubts, that's okay. Bring them to God. God is not going to be thrown off or surprised or shocked about your doubts, about your questions. You can come to Lord even in those times of uncertainties. You can say yes to Jesus and see what he has in store for you. These men did not start a new adventure in Christ because of peer pressure or because, hey, new year, happy new year, let me do something new. They were not running away from something else, but they responded to the invitation of the Messiah. They had an encounter with Christ, an encounter with the Word of God that they read and studied and memorized, had in their hearts, and it was all coming together for them. And even in their partial knowledge, they were moved to tell others about Jesus. They followed the rabbi, Jesus, and not became only hearers of what he said, but they went out and already started inviting people to come and follow him. So what are your next steps as you consider this call to discipleship, this call to be a student, a mentee of Jesus? As you're called to not be just a spectator or a distant fan of God, but to come to be part of God's circle of people who are living the Jesus-following life. Maybe your next step is telling a friend. Telling a friend and say, hey, you know, I don't have all the answers. I'm not really a Bible teacher. But this is what I found in Christ. This is Christ who has saved me from my sin. This is Christ who gives me hope when things go wrong. You don't need to know everything about Jesus to tell a friend about Christ. You don't need to know the whole menu before you recommend a restaurant, right? You don't have to know everything. You can say, hey, I heard this new spot opened in town. Let's go check it out. You don't need to watch the whole plot of a movie before you want to see it. Right? You go say, oh, that Spider-Man flick looks interesting. Got good reviews. Let's go see what that's about. We come, if we wait for us to be perfected, that's not going to happen this lifetime. We follow. It's a journey. It's a discipleship journey. It's a pilgrimage of knowing God. You're never going to know it all. You could memorize the whole Bible in English, then you say, oh, I know it all. Then you're like, oh, you know what? The Bible in English was originally written in Hebrew, the Old Testament. So yeah, it's okay. I have to learn Greek for the New Testament. Learn that. Then you're like, oh, there's a whole historical theology of saying how throughout the years people have understood these scriptures. You know, so there's more and more and more things to learn, which is great and exciting. And maybe your next step is to do that, is to be more educated and study more of the Word. Maybe it's a call to Bible college or to seminary, or it's to use these resource tools to learn in. That's maybe God's calling you to follow Jesus closer in that way, to learn the original languages, or maybe to read the Bible through the year. But even in our imperfection, we can follow God, even in our imperfect knowledge. Maybe your next step is to come and see what God is about. Maybe you believe that the Bible is God's word, that God inspired these words, that they have weight and importance. Maybe you believe that, but are you pursuing that? Are you answering the call to that? Are you living out your faith by spending time in Scripture, reading the Bible, getting to know God through His word? Right? If we believe that the Bible is important, but it doesn't play a large role in our day, is that really belief? Come and see. Come and see the revelations of God in Scriptures. Because you want to hear the word of the Lord. You want to reflect on Him. You want to follow Him. Because God has revealed Himself through the Bible. You want to know God? He gave us the Bible as a primary vehicle to hear His heart, to know Him, to encounter Christ. We have so much other entertainment, things that's more fluffier or more friendly, things that are easier to do and to chew on. But God calls us and gives us the gift of His word. So maybe your next step is to make church a larger priority in your life. Maybe that's your next step. Is, you know, you believe in God, you believe and who He is, and believe that church is important. And maybe you need to connect deeper in this community. To connect deeper, maybe even the online services of seeing music as not a break, but maybe as a time to worship God in whatever way you find appropriate. You know, it's a temptation to treat church like any other social media or any other social commitment. But what if it's really the people of God gathering together to connect with God and connect with one another? How would you treat this time differently? What does it look like to respond to that invitation of being a group of students, a group of disciples following Christ together? Being a disciple is a team sport. So as you enter this new year, continued Happy New Year blessings. We were hoping for a better year. I know I am. I think you are too. And there's some folks who you've carved your, maybe you already hit the gym this morning. You've carved your resolutions. Maybe you're eating differently. Some of you have, I know, think of a theme word to kind of be your theme to guide you from 2022. But in the midst of all this type of refocusing and new you, new year type thing, and new goals and best wishes for 2022, let's not miss the ongoing call of Jesus to come and follow, to come and see God's goodness and come and pursue what God has. What does it look like for you to take your next step of obedience to God? What does it look like to take your next step in faith? Right? It's a journey. It's a journey. How can you take your next? What is God calling you to do in this week, this day, this year, to draw closer, to come and see, to follow? If Jesus is worth our trust, if he's really who he says he is, let us pursue him. Let us spend more time engaging in the word, or participating in church, bringing up questions in prayer, bridging out deeper into our community. Your next steps affirm your identity and clarify your identity as a disciple, to actively follow Jesus in whatever adventure he calls. And realize that your life, your resources, this year is not your own, but it's a gift of God to use for his glory, to follow him and pursue him. The disciples responded to this call, this great adventure in their lives. It's not easy, but it's worthwhile. It's beautiful. It's true. Friends, let us hear now, this year, this week, the calling of Jesus. Come and see. Follow me. Be a disciple of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. I'm going to close in prayer, and then in a few moments we'll transition to our time of communion. Gracious God, you are good, you are faithful. We thank you for this new year, these new opportunities, these new perspectives, a little nudge, Lord, to make a fresh start and to align our lives closer to the lives you call us to live. So, Lord, we pray that you help us to leave behind those things that are hindering us, those unhealthy relationships, those perceptions, those sins that have been weighing us down. Lord, we pray that we may follow you afresh in this year, that we may hear again your invitation to eternal life, your invitation to discipleship, your invitation to come and see, your invitation to follow. So help us to turn away from lesser desires to lesser passions and pursue you with energy, with excitement, with vigor. And Lord, as we come, we also think of our friends. Lord, we know that we have families in our church, Lord, that are recovering from COVID, Lord, and some that are still in the thick of it, Lord. So we pray for them, Lord, pray for healing. Lord, we pray for lack of spread, God. Lord, we pray for those who are grieving loss of loved ones, loss of hopes, loss of dreams. We pray, Lord, that you may give them strength and peace, even in the midst of tough times and difficulties. And God, we pray for those who are embracing the new year with excitement, Lord, for those who expectations of new babies, Lord, of new opportunities, those who are experiencing joy and peace and new relationships. We give you thanks. We pray, God, that you help us to live the way you want us to live. We may honor you with our lives. We pray this in the name of the Lord, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Find some bread and some grape juice or wine as we come together to celebrate the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. Chances are, in the last couple months, you've had a meal with family and friends, whether it be Thanksgiving or Friendsgiving. Perhaps it's appetizers for New Year's Eve or some sort of Christmas dinner or seven fishes of Christmas dinner or some pernil for Nochebuena. You have either this year, I know this year was a little peculiar, or some previous years, you gathered around the table celebrating either, you know, the birth of Christ, thankfulness, the gifts that God has given you in relationships and provision, the promise of a new year. You've experienced that with friends and family. Today, we're going to do, as we do the first Sunday of the month, we celebrate the sacrament of communion. And what that is it's Jesus had the Last Supper with the disciples. He was actually celebrating the Passover meal. The Passover meal, which is something that has done way before Jesus, but he did it with his disciples, with people who he'd been following, who'd been following him for 12 years, who they experienced ups and downs, miracles and heartbreaks, death and healing and resurrection, rejection. And before he went to the cross, he took this meal, which they were accustomed to, part of their rhythm, like we have this rhythm, and he had this meal and gave it another depth of dimension as he looked toward the cross, as he thought about dying and thought about what was ahead and also the fruit of his death, which would be new life and a resurrection of the people and of all of creation. So we're going to have another meal this morning. And for liturgical worship practices, that meal has been kind of simplified into some sort of cracker or bread product and some sort of wine or juice, just as a kind of a way for us to incorporate it in our regular worship rhythm. But as we think of the early church, they had a full meal together as the family, as the people of God. So here we are about to intake. So make sure you have your bread and your cup as we partake in this meal, that Christ is present as he was 2,000 years ago. Supernaturally, Christ is present and has been present our whole time together, but is present here and once again, somewhat supernaturally. We're in all different homes and different places. I'm at the Gowan Chapel here on 46th and Kennedy inside the Grove Church building. And you are where you are, but we are connected to Christ. We're connected to one another, and to actually to all those who follow Jesus. So let us partake in this supper and this meal. So if you are a follower of Christ, if you are a disciple, you're invited to welcome to participate that. If you're somewhere else on your spiritual journey, just use it as a time to reflect and to think on what God has done. Friends at home, let us go into our great Thanksgiving prayer. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Holy and right it is, and our joyful duty to give thanks to you at all times and in all places, O Lord our Creator. Almighty and everlasting God, you created heaven with all its hosts and the earth with all its plenty. You have given us life and being, and you preserve us by your providence. But you have shown us the fullness of your love in sending into the world your Son, Jesus Christ, the eternal Word made flesh for us and for our salvation. For this precious gift of this mighty Savior who has reconciled us to you, we praise and bless you, O God. With your whole church on earth and with all the company of heaven, we worship and adore your glorious name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Most righteous God, we remember in this supper the perfect sacrifice offered once on the cross by our Lord Jesus Christ for the sin of the whole world. And in the joy of his resurrection and in expectation of him coming again, we offer ourselves to you as holy and living sacrifices. Together we proclaim the mystery of the faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Send your Holy Spirit upon us, we pray, that the bread which we break and the cup which we bless may be to us the communion of the body and blood of Christ. Grant that being joined together in him, we may attain to the unity of the faith and grow up into all things into Christ our Lord. As this grain has been gathered from many fields into a loaf and grapes from many hills into a cup, grant, O Lord, that your whole church may soon be gathered from the ends of the earth into your kingdom. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus, the same night he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Brothers and sisters of Christ, let us take the bread together. The Lord Jesus, the same night he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Friends at home, let us partake this bread together. The bread which we break is the communion of the body of Christ. Take, eat, remember, and believe. After the same manner also, he took the cup when they had supped, saying, "This cup is the new testament of my blood. This do as often as you drink of it, in remembrance of me." Friends, the cup which you bless is the communion of the blood of Christ. Take, drink, remember, and believe. Brothers and sisters, since the Lord has now fed us at his table, let us praise God's holy name with heartfelt thanksgiving. Bless the Lord, O my soul,
and all that is within me, bless his holy name.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and do not forget all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquity,
who heals all your diseases,
who redeems your life from the pit,
who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy.
The Lord is merciful and gracious,
slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love.
He does not deal with us according to our sins,
nor repay us according to our iniquities.
For as the heavens are high above the earth,
so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him.
As far as the east is from the west,
so far does he remove our transgressions from us.
As a father has compassion for his children, so the Lord has compassion for those who fear him. Who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, will also give us all things with him. Therefore shall my mouth and heart show forth the praise of the Lord from this time forth forevermore. Amen. Amen, amen. I want to thank you for participating in our online service, for breaking bread with us. And for those of you who have given financially, we want to give you thanks for that. We know there's a lot of places where you could have given, but we appreciate you prioritizing the local church and allowing us to minister to people in our neighborhood, people online, and of course, supporting missions and missionaries and theological training institutions here in the U.S. and across the world. So thank you for being our partner in that way. If there's a way we could pray for you, let us know in the comments or send a message. Some of you have already have, and we're praying for Joanne and for other folks that you have shared us that are heavy on our hearts and high up on our prayer list. So let us continue to pray for one another and each other. I want to thank you for that as well. In a few moments, there's going to be some questions just to bring home the message of how do we make this, you know, how do we wrestle with discipleship and how do we follow and say, "Yes, Lord, I'm coming, I'm seeing, I'm following." So in a few moments, we'll have that after this final song of worship. Before we go any further, receive this blessing. May God bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you and be gracious to you right now and always. Amen. God bless and see you next Sunday. Thank you.
heaven.